Compassion and all encompassing reality. Lord, Professor Dorrien is the author of 20 books and more than 300 articles that range across the fields of social ethics, philosophy, theology, political economics, social and political theory, religious history, cultural criticism, and intellectual history. Philosopher Cornel West describes him as the preeminent social ethicist in North America today. Philosopher Robert Neville calls him the most rigorous theological historian of our time, moving from analysis of social context and personal struggles through the most abstruse theological and metaphysical issues. Dorrien told an interviewer in 2016, he said, "I am a dog who began as a solidarity activist, became an Episcopal cleric at 30, became an academic at 35, and never quite settled on the field. So now I explore the intersections of too many fields." And if I may add, two of my personal fascinations with his scholarship is his demonstration of the influence of Hegelian philosophy on W.E.B. Du Bois, an important influence that other philosophers or professors like Apia have now recognized in a modern relevance as the personalism. In 2018, Professor Dorrien won the Choice Award of the American Library Association for his book, Breaking White Supremacy, Martin Luther King Jr., and the Black Social Gospel, which Choice described as intellectual history at its finest. A triumph of careful scholarship, rigorous argument, clear prose, unblinking judgment, and groundbreaking conclusions, indispensable. It is an honor to listen to Professor Dorrien speak on this occasion and poignancy of the topic he has decided to explore. Ladies and gentlemen, please let us put our hands together for Professor Dorrien.
Thank you, my friend, for that generous and kind introduction. Good evening, friends. It is a great privilege for me to be gathered with you in this historic and sacred place. There is something to be said for the wrenching, painful, awkward reckoning with our nation's racial pathology that has become our daily reality. At least the reckoning has come. It cannot be done quickly, and there are so many sides to it that it's pointless to worry about finding the right one. We begin begin where we are and we try to make sense of how we got here. It was not until 1967, with 1 year of life remaining to him, that Martin Luther King Jr. admitted there was a backlash raging out there against the civil rights movement. King had persistently refused to say there was a backlash because that kind of language always blamed him for it. Then he wrote his last book, Where We Go From Here, a title taken from the Easter narrative in the Gospel of Mark. And King said, obviously, there's a backlash. But he argued that the cause of the backlash was more important than the immediate politics of dealing with it. Racial hostility was always there, and it had never been otherwise. The civil rights movement merely brought this hostility to the surface. Coping with that reality was, and is, a spiritual discipline. Tonight we are linking the idea of universal human rights to its foremost champion of the 20th century, Martin Luther King. The idea that there is such a thing as an individual person, and the corollary idea that this individual person bears a sacred dignity by virtue of being a child of God, these ideas came from Christianity, which provided the groundwork of the modern idea of human rights. The fact that these ideas came from Christianity and nowhere else is a problem for every form of human rights universalism. Today, there are many versions of human rights theory. Some are based on natural law theory, or Kantian personalism, or the overlapping consensus theory of John Rawls, or the capabilities theory of Walters-Sleyon, or a similar theory. Each theory differently addresses the problems of cultural pluralism and conflicting cultural norms. The problems are notoriously daunting, yet the idea of human rights has not diminished on their account, for human rights is like the idea of justice or the common good. We never get it definitively, yet we dare not cease from trying to get it right so that every person can love whoever they love and be whoever they are and flourish under God's love and grace. Yes. Martin Luther King Jr. epitomized the Christian basis of the human rights idea and what is at stake in struggling for it. He didn't come from nowhere, for King was steeped in a black social gospel tradition that had everything at stake in the idea of sacred human dignity. By convention, we describe the movement of 1955 to 1968 as the civil rights movement. It was incomparably beautiful, daring, traumatic, and searing in American history. It abounded with noble visions, resounded with magnificent rhetoric, ended in nightmarish despair, and does not end. It put on global display the ravages of racism and racial caste in this country. It sang and preached and marched for a better world. King became a global icon by assailing his country's racism and condemning its economic injustice and opposing its war in Vietnam and standing with the poor and oppressed and expounding a vision of liberation and being assassinated for doing so. To me, this story surpasses all other American stories because it is the passion narrative of our time. But it's merely our convention to call it the Civil Rights Movement. The Civil Rights Movement began in 1884 with the National Afro-American League, led by Thomas Fortune, and the Afro-American Council, led by Alexander Walters. It had a brilliant moment of hope in the Niagara Movement of 1905 to 1909, led by W.E.B. Du Bois. It entered a second phase of activism in 1910 with the founding of the NAACP, an organization with an incomparable legacy of bravery and accomplishment in this country. The NAACP was headquartered in New York, and it marched through the federal courts, but its lifeblood came from 40,000 black churches spread across the country. Mm-hmm. When lightning struck in Montgomery, Alabama in 1955, the civil rights movement exploded into its third phase. In all three phases, the movement had leaders who preached the social gospel that the church has a mission to struggle for social justice.
Yes.
There was a white social gospel that focused on urbanization and economic justice, which created the ecumenical movement and transformed seminaries like the Boston University School of Theology. The white social gospel is justly renowned for inventing the field of social ethics and for creating all the peace and justice ministries in white mainline denominations. But the black social gospel has a far greater legacy than the famous white one. Its founders included William Simmons, Alexander Crummell, Reverdy Ransom, Ida Wells Barnett, Alexander Walters, Nanny Burroughs, Richard Wright Jr., George W. Whitby, Adam Clayton Powell Sr. They began with a terrible question. What would a new abolition be? Now that abolition has come and gone, how should churches respond to this epidemic of hostility, lynching, racial terrorism?
Yes.
The founders were an embattled minority in their own denominations because the social gospel was divisive and it got people in trouble. The next generation of black social gospel leaders espoused social gospel theology from the beginning of their careers. Mordecai Johnson, Benjamin Mays, George Kelsey, J. Pius Barber, James Farmer, Adam Clayton Powell Jr., Howard Thurman. Every figure I just named was a role model, a personal role model for Dr. King. Their legacy is immense, paving the way for the King generation of James Lawson, Andy Young, Diane Nash, Fannie Lou Hamer, Joe Lowery, Pauli Murray, John Lewis. White social gospel leaders took for granted their access to the general public. Black social gospel leaders could barely imagine what it felt like to address the general public. They had to create a counter-public sphere merely to have a public. They fought to abolish Jim Crow, lynching, and economic injustice, refuting the racist culture that demeaned their human dignity. They established that progressive theology could be combined with social justice politics in black church contexts. They urged church communities to welcome the migrant stranger. They refused to believe that churches were hopelessly self-centered, provincial, insular, anti-intellectual, and conservative, even though they heard that judgment all the time. They said the key to changing the U.S. already existed in the ordinary congregations that gathered every Sunday. It was hard to believe, but they said it persistently. Only a minority of African-American congregations has ever supported social justice activists. Black churches have always been widely diverse theologically, politically, culturally, and socially. There has never been a dominant or singular black church in the mold of the civil rights movement, which ironically is a social gospel construct. The very influence of the social gospel idea of what the black church is or should be has obscured that it is a social gospel idea, which many churches reject. The founders were distinct and marginalized in their interactions with the white social gospel and within Afro-American Christianity. They were marginalized in the ecumenical movement because white Christianity was every bit as segregated and white supremacist as the rest of American society. They were marginalized in black churches for pressing a national social justice agenda and for adopting social gospel theology. Some of them succeeded sufficiently to win denominational positions, take over the publishing houses, and change the mainstream.
Yes.
Sometimes they played into the hands of white racists, espousing the worst aspects of what we today call the politics of respectability. This approach recycled harmful stereotypes about Afro-American culture and manners. The nationalist tradition, in particular, often folded ugly denigrations of black humanity into its message of racial solidarity. Some social gospel preaching about family life caused particular harm to women in perpetuating stereotypes. Many social gospel ministers exhorted women to keep the churches going with no chance whatsoever of becoming church or public leaders. Whenever they preached about gay and lesbian sexuality, it was in condemnation. But to achieve any of its goals, the black social gospel needed courageous and accomplished leaders. And without their witness, the theology and legacy of King are incomprehensible.
Yes.
There was no seminary that truly bridged the two social gospels. A few black social gospel founders studied at the University of Chicago Divinity School. A couple of others studied at Rochester Seminary. Meanwhile, Boston University came late to the white social gospel and very late to the black social gospel. But BU developed a social gospel conscience. In 1917, it founded a school of religious education and social service that grappled with the immigration issue. And after World War II, it became the place to come if you were raised in the black social gospel. All along, BU had the right theology for it. The post-Kantian personal idealism of Gordon Parker Brown, Albert Knudsen, and Edgar Brightman. Boston personalism was epistemologically dualistic, ethically Kantian, metaphysically pluralistic, theologically liberal, methodologically experiential, and eventually committed to the social gospel. It taught that personality is real and transcendentally important.
Yes.
The soul is essentially active, not a substance. It's known immediately as the experience of consciousness, and God is the spirit of the world that lights our souls.
Hallelujah.
The school of theology was slow to show why personalist theology really mattered, until Walter Mueller became dean, and a string of black students came here. King was just in that tradition by flow. King's family had taught him that he was as good as anybody, no matter what white society said. He studied at Morehouse College and Crozier Seminary. He read books by Edgar Brightman, and he came here to study with Brightman. Then King wrote a doctoral dissertation that fought off American racism without saying a word about race or racism. Two eminent theologians, Paul Tillich and Henry Nelson Wyman, established God's existence by definition without attributing personality to God. Tillich taught that God is the ground of being that cannot be denied unless one denies the very reality of being itself. Wyman taught that God is the something of supreme value that cannot be denied unless one denies the reality of the good. King steered back and forth between Tillich and Wyman, objecting that both of them identify personality with limited human personality, but God is not limited by personality. Personality means two things, self-consciousness and self-direction. Applied to God, the idea of personality implies no limitation at all. God is the personal ground of the infinite value of human personality. This two-sided credo was King's theological foundation. If the worth of personality is the ultimate value in life, America's racial caste system was abhorrently evil. And it was distinctly evil on Christian grounds. Evil is precisely that which degrades personality, the sacred dignity of every human life.
Yes.
The purpose of American racial caste was to humiliate, exclude, and degrade the personhood of African Americans. If Christianity meant anything in this context, it had to shout a contrary word. Rosa Parks got arrested and lightning struck in Montgomery. The movement made King, not the other way around, but the movement that swept into prominence would not have caught fire without him.
That's right.
Montgomery happened because Montgomery had English professor Joanne Robinson, the Montgomery Women's Political Council, Rosa Parks, and former NAACP leader Edie Dixon. They were ready to challenge bus segregation when Parks provided the perfect test case by getting arrested. Somebody had to speak for the boycott. Nixon excoriated the ministers when nobody volunteered. Kane walked in late, and he took offense at being excoriated. "Who are you calling a coward?" he demanded. History turned in a moment, because it turned out that the newcomer in a bow tie was willing to risk his life. King had 20 minutes to plan that night what he would say. He had one guiding thought as he headed to Holt Street Church. Somehow, I have to be militant and moderate at the same time. And so it was. Last week at the MLK event in Roxbury, I lingered over the Holt Street address. Tonight I'm going to go for what came of it. King founded the Southern Christian Leadership Conference to protest, to spread protest without fire. He relied on Bayard Rustin, Stanley Levison, and Ella Baker to help him organize the SCLC and to personally link the fledgling theatrical church-based movement in the South to the established institutional, mostly secular movement based in New York City. Rustin, Levison, and Baker were veterans of the old left who fondly remembered how the CIO used unions, and unions used strikes and boycotts and marches to make gains for economic justice. They were also chastened by this history, because the CIO strategy of fusing anti-racism with unions and socialism failed in the 1940s. SCLC was a second chance, notwithstanding that Rustin was a socialist Quaker, Levison was a Jewish former communist, and Baker's experience of the black church made her averse to charismatic preachers. The SCLC ministers and board members did not like King's reliance on Rustin, Levison, and Baker. They were especially anxious about Rustin because he was gay, and King, in turn, was emphatic about needing him. He took his stride that Rustin, Levison, and Baker had old left backgrounds. It was one of God's mysteries why so many communists and so few white liberals had cared about black Americans. He took for granted that the best social gospel was a social democratic and anti-communist version of democratic socialism, because he studied Walter Rauschenbusch in Seminary, and he knew that Mays, Johnson, Farmer, Thurman, and Farmer were all Rauschenbusch democratic socialists. They cited Rauschenbusch from memory that political democracy cannot survive without economic democracy.
Yes.
For a while, SCLC floundered, even as King became famous. City governments took away the busing issue, and King struggled to keep the organization alive. He was sensitive and peaceable. It repulsed him to imagine that he would be the cause of getting people killed. It took the student sit-in explosion of 1960 and the founding of SNCC to push King into actual Gandhian disruption instead of merely talking about it. King resolved to raise hell in the most hostile cities he could find, so he selected lieutenants who were willing to do it. SCLC became a fire alarm outfit relying on street theater and heroic education. It was long on charismatic male ministers who did not treat their female allies with the respect they deserved. And Martin Luther King was no exception. But both organizations stoked protest without fire. From 1960 to the end, King got more radical and angry every succeeding year. The great demonstration in Birmingham was slow to catch fire. It was saved by marching children, and it nearly ended disastrously. But it caused President Kennedy to propose the Civil Rights Act. The campaign in St. Augustine was a bloodbath that did end badly, except the Civil Rights Act came out of it. The beatings in Selma helped to produce the Voting Rights Act, and afterward, the movement got battered viciously in Chicago, with no political victory at all. Until 1966, King refused to say that white Americans never intended to integrate their schools and neighborhoods. Then he got pelted with rocks in Chicago, and he said scathingly, cautioning SCLC at Frogmore at their retreat, quote, "The white man literally sought to annihilate the Indian. If you look through the history of the world, this very seldom happened." King said, "This is what black Americans are up against." Very near the end, in his last Christmas sermon, he made his usual vow to endure suffering and respond to violence with soul force and to love the oppressors. But now he said it by counterposing the dream and the nightmare, invoking the nightmares of the four church girls murdered in Birmingham and the miserable poverty of urban neighborhoods and American cities on fire and the war in Vietnam. At the end, Martin Luther King was unfathomably exhausted and depressed, living on the edge of despair. Yes. But he dared not give up hope. Quote, "Yes," he said, "I am personally the victim of deferred dreams, of blasted hopes. But in spite of that, I close today by saying, I still have a dream, because you know, you can't give up in life." Unquote. We're now West, delineating the intellectual and existential sources that shape Martin Luther King rightly names four in order of importance: prophetic black church Christianity, prophetic liberal Christianity, prophetic Gandhian nonviolence, and prophetic American civil religion. West says that King embodied the best of American Christendom by synthesizing these sources. With that, those very four things define precisely the black social gospel that influenced King. King stood in the tradition of black social gospel intellectuals who heard the prophetic gospel in the black church, who appropriated social gospel liberalism, who engaged the Gandhian revolution, and who called America to stop betraying its wanted ideals of democracy, freedom, and equality. The weakest link in this chain was the one that white America lifted up after King was gone. King the dreamer who called America to its own breed. King himself played down this trope in his later life, as it did not comport very well with the surging tide of black anger that he shared with the Black Power movement. It became even more problematic as soon as he was gone. The more that white liberals embraced King as a hero, the more ambiguous he became for black Americans still denigrated by white supremacism. It became hard to remember how militant and radical King had been. He seemed to be wholly outstripped by the Black Power movement, failing to break through his image as the civil rights leader best suited to prop up white liberalism. Even King's sympathetic biographer, David Levering Lewis, writing 2 years after King's death, contended that King specialized in making his audiences feel good. Lewis said that King evoked deeply pleasurable emotions in the middle class blacks and whites who flocked to hear him, never threatening anyone, quote, "Almost till the end, the meliorism of the social gospel, and more viscerally, that of the black bourgeoisie, stayed with Martin, despite the instructive lessons in Karl Marx and Reinhold Niebuhr," unquote. Well, there was some truth to that, and it was terribly misleading. Martin Luther King did not become the most hated person in this country on a misunderstanding. He struck with audacity and forcefulness in the most hateful cities he could find. And at the end, he was more radical than anybody around him. He dragged SCLC to Chicago. He frightened and appalled the civil rights establishment by coming out against the Vietnam War. He railed against American militarism and what he called the colonial mentality. Then he committed to the Poor People's Campaign, and the entire executive staff was against him. Near the end, he doubled down on the path of public sacrifice. As a child, he sang that he wanted to be more and more like Jesus. In his last years, he got very close to it. Cain told the SCLC staff, quote, "When I took up the cross, I recognized its meaning. The cross is something that you bear, and ultimately, that you die on." The Poor People's Campaign topped Cain's previous forays into risky, controversial, chaotic protest. Now he outflanked even James Bevel, his usual barometer of going too far. Cain did not claim that he had all the political angles figured. Maybe his lieutenants were right about the politics. He didn't know where this was heading politically. He only knew with whom he needed to be. The poorest of the poor. The poor and the vulnerable. The people who were nobody in this society. In his last book, Cain stressed that freedom has no reality apart from power. Power is integral to hope and liberation, and freedom is precisely participation in power. The goal of the civil rights movement was to transform the lack of power of black Americans and to create a vital, interpersonal, organized power, the ability to achieve a purpose. All could be free, but only if all are empowered to participate. Freedom and integration go together to build the beloved community, a universal goal embracing all peoples and all nations. Mm-hmm. Cain said it at the height of a national backlash that was every bit as raw, lacerating, and traumatic as the one we're living in now, mm-hmm. and actually far more violent. I am making a continuity argument about the black social gospel tradition, but I am making it in a way that emphasizes how King moved beyond it.
Yes.
For all that Daddy King influenced his son, neither Daddy King nor any of his buddies would have kept the bus strike going in Montgomery, or struck hard in Birmingham and St. Augustine, or raised hell in Chicago, yeah. or opposed the Vietnam War, yeah. or spurned President Johnson, or marched for worker rights in Memphis, or called an army of the poor to descend on the nation's capital.
Yes.
The story of the civil rights movement illuminates like no other story the miserable trauma we are living through today, because white supremacy, white lash, and the struggle against hopelessness are very much our problems, despite twice electing a black president, and also because of it.
Celebration of King, which is our proper duty.
The beauty of the great
death by execution is practiced.
Inhale dignity
who are being trafficked for sexual purposes in many regions around the globe.
May they know dignity and experience justice.
Those who are tortured or abused in any way as part of a penal and or legal system, and those who do not receive equal treatment before the law, including prisoners.
May they know dignity and experience justice.
Those who are denied freedom of belief and religion, and those denied freedom of opinion and information. Let us read. Lord,